DHBs must absorb them.
Dr. David Clark.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Look, the estimates hearings were a lively affair this year. But before I speak about them, I just want to acknowledge the Honourable Annette King, my predecessor, and her huge contribution to health in this country as one of the best health ministers this country has ever had. And I want to say that as I go around the country and discuss health as a relatively new member in the portfolio, although I've been associate health with Annette King for 3 years before that, that the feedback I'm consistently getting is that people miss in this sector the engagement they had with the Honourable Annette King. They felt like they had a minister who listened, and now they express despair that the current minister is so disengaged with the sector. In fact, his disengagement is such that they are now starting to claim and believe that Tony Ryle was a fantastic health minister, because the contrast is so strong. At least Tony Ryle was on the phone, he was regularly following up, he cared about what was going on in the sector, and now they have an absentee minister and they are frustrated. And Mr. Speaker, this came through in the hearings. This came through in the hearings. The minister in the hearings, and this was the most shocking thing of all, it was widely reported in the media because they couldn't believe it either. He said he would have to check my figures when I suggested that there were 533,000 people who couldn't afford to go to the GP in the previous year. 533,000 people. The minister said I'd have to check the members' figures. I've never heard of that figure before. That's new to me. That is the minister's own figure. That comes out of his ministry. The minister doesn't read his papers. And that is one of the major things that is going wrong in this sector. It can be, well, it is the kindest explanation for the blunders that are happening in the sector currently. And I think we'll see more to come, for example, on the budget blunder that was. The minister announced the wrong funding on budget day. The minister announced the wrong funding. I think this is unprecedented. I would challenge the minister to give another example of a minister announcing the wrong health funding on budget day. I don't think it has ever happened. And I think we will find out. I think there's still evidence that will come to light that will tell us the minister knew about this well before the budget day and still chose to announce the wrong amount on budget day. And that is frightening. In this country, if we have a minister prepared to mislead the country about how many health dollars have been allocated into whom,
you can't infer that someone is misled. So just be careful what you're saying. You can use other words, but not misled. Dr. David Clark.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I will not say repeat what I just said, but I have a deep concern that the false amount of money was announced on budget day to the public in terms of the allocations to DHBs, Mr. Speaker. And the fact that the minister didn't know how many New Zealanders couldn't afford to go to the GP, even though it is in the major survey that his ministry publishes, I think speaks volumes. In the hearing itself, we asked questions of the minister around mental health. And we asked why the government had failed to act to intervene when we have a growing crisis in mental health, Mr. Speaker. We raised the issue of 60% increase, a 60% increase in the number of people taking up mental health services in New Zealand in the past decade, and the fact that funding had only increased by 28% in the same period. Now, the minister, when asked about funding increases in the mental health sector, consistently says he doesn't know what the figure is. We've done the calculation. We can tell the minister it is less than half the percentage increase in the demand for mental health services. And he was prepared, I will say, in that hearing, to answer questions on the failures of acute services in mental health, because there'd been a damning Auditor General report recently released that showed that many people are being released into the community without a plan in place to look after them, mental health patients, and that they were being released on the basis of least need. Not that they were fit to go out again, not that they were ready to go back into the community, but that there were more patients desperately in need and that plans were not in place. And they were going out in some cases, Mr. Speaker, they were going out into caravan parks. And the and the DHB's concern had no idea where they were going, Mr. Speaker. So the Minister came prepared to answer questions on acute, Mr. Speaker. Came prepared to answer questions on acute need in the sector, but he didn't have an answer as to when the solutions would be put in place. And we've had ministry officials before Select Committee since, and there'll be more on that to come, because I'm afraid that the answers we're getting are not satisfactory in terms of acute care, and they're not satisfactory in terms of providing a service where people with mild to moderate mental health access can get care that they need in the community. Unless they're wealthy and can independently access private services, we know that there is a huge gap there, and that's widely acknowledged in the sector. The Minister, however, talked about a $25 million contingency that he had launched. Now, he launched that, we know, a week before the budget. He made a speech which announced a review that wasn't called a review, that was going to be reviewed in 3 years' time, if I remember rightly, around the quality of services. That was his only announcement a week before the budget, because we know that he had been told he couldn't make an announcement about the mental health funding contingency. And he said that he would make an announcement about that in due course. He was going to put a paper to Cabinet soon. Well, Mr. Speaker, the embarrassing thing that happened on Budget Day was that the Minister got up again and delivered out these press releases saying he was going to deliver a Cabinet paper to Cabinet soon. The same story. Dog ate his homework. Hasn't prepared anything on a response to the growing mental health crisis. That Minister has not got any answers. He's got a contingency fund, and we still don't know. The budget was on the 25th of May, and we still don't know any one thing that he is doing in the mental health area. That is outrageous, Mr. Speaker. That is absolutely outrageous in a growing crisis in this country that the Minister has no plan. And it speaks to 9 years of a government that, if it had any ideas, has run out of them, Mr. Speaker, or been convinced that they were too bold or too scary or something, because there is no action, Mr. Speaker, on mental health. The Minister doesn't know his facts and figures. We assess that in terms of the over half a million people who couldn't access their GP. And there have been studies, of course, since, and I raised these with the Minister, which show that one in four adults now cannot access the primary health care they need in New Zealand. That includes oral care, that includes picking up their scripts and so on. And that is the growing inequality under this Minister's watch. And we have the primary health sector now in revolt as it is concerned about the lack of funding, budget after budget after budget. And this budget was no different. They got $9 million this year, and 2 years in a row, they've asked for more than double that, because they know there's a desperate need to fund primary care to keep people out of hospitals. And of course, since then, we've heard more about the injections and the skin lesion removals that are being used by the government to pump up its elective surgery statistics, instead of investing in the long-term care, in the way that the Honourable Annette King did when she was Health Minister, long-term strategies to make sure that New Zealanders were getting the services they need, that money was being invested in prevention rather than in meeting the short-term elective surgery targets that are made to try to make it look like the government is doing something when we know it has cut money. And this was another challenge I put to the Minister, and I have to say he spent a lot of his prepared speech talking about the Labor Party's analysis of the shortage of money he's put in the system. He spent a huge amount of his time there trying to rebuff what he knows is a very challenging truth, and that is that when an independent economic agency went and looked at the Treasury figures, they found that $2.3 billion has been taken out of the health system, and that is the money that would have been required to deliver the existing level of services in the health system. That $2.3 billion, that's what more money would have needed to have been put in since 2009 just to retain existing service levels. And of course, in this story about the injections, the eye injections and the skin lesion removals, there we have the proof in the pudding. Case-weighted discharges, as they're called, are dropping. You know, the number of surgeries being performed at that high end is not keeping up in many DHBs. We've seen a drop-off. And if you take away the skin lesions, you take away the eye injections, and you take away those surgeries that could have been performed outside of the hospital, there were actually fewer surgeries performed in the Auckland DHB, fewer surgeries performed in the county's Manukau DHB, fewer surgeries performed in the Bay of Plenty DHB, fewer surgeries performed in the Waikato DHB, fewer surgeries performed in the Northland DHB. These are growing populations, and year on year, there are fewer surgeries being performed, Minister, and that is because this Minister seems content to watch the demise of the health sector under his watch.
Honourable Dr. Jonathan Coleman.
Mr. Chair, we've just had two...